Friends, sorry I'm back again. There was some technical problem, but I'm back again. So let me start answering questions. There is a very interesting question that has been asked by Shri Sudhakar Suradkar. The question says, it is our feeling that BJP do not allow think open by their MPs and express themselves. RSS watches closely. This is a very interesting question. First of all, let me clarify that I do not belong to any political party, including BJP. I also want to emphasize that I do not belong to RSS. I have not joined any organization. I am sitting in the Indian Parliament, upper house of the Indian Parliament, as an independent member of Parliament. So the question of anybody giving me any sense of direction or guidance simply doesn't arise. The only guide that I have is Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar. Okay, let me turn to other questions that we have received. The one question that has come up here is Sumit Kharat is saying, is it possible for two students to meet you? Of course it is possible, and I keep meeting hundreds of students, and I keep giving speeches. I go to Mumbai, Pune and rest of the Maharashtra very often. So whenever my program is there, you students can always come and meet me there, and I would be delighted. And I do meet literally hundreds of students. Day before yesterday I was in Nashik inaugurating one branch of a small cooperative bank, and I met hundreds of students there. So that's an ongoing process. There is one more question that has been asked. Capitalism is an instrument can do to annihilate caste. Yes, it is. It can be. It depends on how it is administered. But for annihilation of caste, you must read what Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar wrote. He prepared a speech that was not delivered, but it was printed as a book. And the book is Annihilation of Caste. That will give you answer to all the questions that you have about the annihilation of caste. There is one question. Most of the Ambedkarite youth is jobless in rural area. Right now, you are in the government. So I request you to do something. Okay. Varsha Govande is saying, what is the difference between economic growth and economic development? Are the measures of economic growth are sufficient to measure the economic development? How do we measure economic development? Economic growth and economic development, these two are different things. Economic development is a much broader concept. When we talk about how the production, the value addition in the economy is growing, we are talking about economic growth. You know, because millions of citizens work day and night every day, and they contribute, they add value to the production process. So that annual value added is summed up together in terms of what is called gross domestic product. The growth of gross domestic product over the years is the rate of economic growth. Okay, when we talk about economic development, we are talking about a much broader notion. We are not only talking about economic growth, we are talking about development of institutions, development of society, and a whole range of things which come under economic development. Economic growth can be measured, but economic development cannot be quantified in a formal sort of way. We can only have an index of economic development, but not a measure of economic development. Then there is a question. There is a question, sir. You know, somebody is saying that Dhangar Samaj reservation. What is your thought on reservation system? That is a very, very good question. This question comes from Omkar Sanjay Helaskar. You know, why is the reservation needed? Reservation is needed, in my view, because of the innate inability of our system to be just and fair. If the system were just and fair, we do not need reservation. But because the system is not fair, because of that, we do not have proper opportunities. If you look at the actual job opportunities and actual job openings and jobs taken and look at the distribution of the caste, you will find that few castes which are small in number are occupying disproportionately large number of positions, whereas very large mass of underprivileged society, in spite of their talent, they are not getting the opportunities. Now this has to be corrected, and for that, for those people who have been historically neglected, historically those who have suffered, to give them the opportunity to make something out of their life, that is why we need reservation. Reservations are needed because of the inability of our system to be just and fair. So reservation is necessary. My position is that reservation is necessary not only in the public sector, but reservation is also needed in private sector. I have another question. Bhagwant Kshirasagar is asking, education loan to the needy without mortgage assets, banks refuse in general. Now this is a real problem. You know, in the last few years, government has liberalized and made opportunities to access loan of 15 lakh rupees. Now these are the instructions, but many banks are not following that, and they are insisting on mortgage of assets. This is something that I certainly would like to push for in the parliament session, which actually begins tomorrow, the next parliament session. Paresh Sawad has asked, what is your message to young professionals who are passionate to work for social entrepreneurship? That relevant to the vision of Dr. Ambedkar. I'm not clear what you are saying, but my message to the young professionals is that please remember that this is an age of competition. Spardhatmak gunavatta ha ya yugacha dharma ahe. That is why I feel that in whatever you do, you have to do your very best. Nothing but your very best will suffice. The competition is going to be more and more, and therefore it is going to get the best out of you. And therefore you have to ride over the competition and give your best shot at everything that you do. Nothing should be done half-heartedly. I want to remind you that it is a low aim that is a crime. Failure is not a crime. But a lot of people, you know, they have such low aim that they are committing a crime against themselves. Then there is a question, Harshadeep Ghuge is saying, is there any economic index to measure social condition of Dalit in India? Best way to measure that, internationally acclaimed one, is Human Development Index, HDI. And the methodology for Human Development Index has been constructed and developed over a period of time. What we can do is that Human Development Index is constructed for India, as a whole, and that is already being done, and the ranking, global ranking, has been done, and we are pretty much below. We are about 134th rank in 184 countries which compile HDI, Human Development Index. Taking cue from your suggestion, I think we need to develop the Human Development Index for different socio-religious communities, including Dalits. I think that would give a fair assessment of where do they stand and how far they have to go. There is another question. This is the question on by Onkar Sanjay Helaskar. The question says, what is your thought on Dr. Rajan's tenure and his decision of leaving the post after the first term? I think Dr. Raghuram Rajan did a wonderful job. He is one of the finest governors that we have had. But as you are aware, ours is a big country and it has a lot of potential and a lot of very good people available with us. So moving away of one person does not make any difference. He did very good job. I can find out and tell you some of the mistakes that he has made, but we don't want to go into that. What I'm saying is that he is an internationally acclaimed economist. He did very well. That's a very good thing that he did, but nobody, and mark my word, nobody in our country is indispensable. We are probably the brightest people in the world, and we have many more people, competent people. So going away by one person does not make any difference to our system. Then I have a question by Anurag Shandilya. Manual scavenging, the question reads, manual scavenging is still rampant. All government extend the deadline. As the MP of Rajya Sabha, will you raise this question in current session? And what will you do as MP to stop manual scavenging? This is the best question I have got. In fact, I have already decided to make one of the primary issues that I will be taking up in the parliament would be manual scavenging. And different ways of now I'm back. There are different ways of sorry for the disconnect, momentary disconnect. I'm going to take manual scavenging. Manual scavenging is a blot on Indian culture, and in spite of the enactment, you know, I worked at it when I was a member of planning commission. In spite of the act that has been made, you know, the actual implementation is very poor. Many states used to tell us in the planning commission that we have no manual scavenging. The largest amount of manual scavenging takes place in the railways. And in many states, and there was a big survey undertaken, we have been extending the deadline, but time has come to stop this blot on Indian culture. At this time and age, to have manual scavenging is a terrible thing to happen. And it is a blot on us, and we must remove that blot as early as possible. There are many more questions. One more question that's coming up is this, that what is your view? This is question from Abhijit Mane Patil. Can new governor support GST? You know, it doesn't matter whether the governor supports GST or not, because GST, goods and services tax, GST bill is the most important reform that is currently being undertaken after 1991. Remember that there was a major crisis in our country in 1991, and Dr. Manmohan Singh, as the finance minister, started the new so-called new economic policy, and the reform process took a quantum leap from 1992 onwards. In the last 25 years, I think after that event, the biggest single reform that is going to happen is GST, goods and services tax. This is a reform that will unite the entire country as one economic entity, as one market, and it can add to the growth rate of our country. So this is something which is currently being debated, and it is at the final stage, and I am certainly very hopeful that in the current session of the parliament, which begins tomorrow, GST bill would be passed. In our wider national interest, we must pass the GST bill. Onkar Sanjay Hilaskar has asked a question. Sir, I am studying in National Institute of Bank Management, Pune. Will it be possible for you to come to my college for giving us guidance on the economy of India in the next 20 years? I certainly can. In fact, when I worked with the Reserve Bank of India for 31 years, every year, several times, in fact, I used to go to NIBM and give a talk there, and I keep accepting those invitations. So if a proper invitation is received, I certainly would be willing to come to NIBM and give a talk on the subject that you want about the Indian economy in the next 20 years. I would love to do that. There are many more questions. Any more questions that you guys have? Any more questions? Okay, there is one more question that I have received early on. And this is a question about, this is a delicate one. This one says, Siddharth Kamble ji has asked this question. It says, sir, you have the qualification, you have the experience, still, why are you out of the race of RBI governor? Now, this is a very delicate question. As you are aware, only 2 months back, I became member of Rajya Sabha. We have had in the past RBI governor leaving the governorship to become a Rajya Sabha member. The best example is Dr. Bimal Jalan. Bimal Jalan cut short his tenure as an RBI governor to take over as a nominated member of Rajya Sabha. I have skipped that and I have directly become the member of nominated member of Rajya Sabha. There is no precedent where a Rajya Sabha member of parliament in Rajya Sabha goes back as a governor. So my position is that I'm out of race because I have crossed that level and I have gone elsewhere. But I remain open to suggestions. Okay, there is another question. Onkar Sanjay is saying, we will love to see you as RBI governor. Well, I appreciate your feelings. I would also love to see myself as RBI governor. But I think that looks very, very difficult at this stage because I have crossed that and gone to Rajya Sabha. So that is unlikely to happen, I think. I'm sorry for that break. Anurag Shandilya is saying that in recent times, Dalit atrocities have risen. All political parties are playing Dalit card, but no one is seriously and sincerely wants to debate and work on this action. As the MP of Rajya Sabha, what do you see? This is again a very, very good question. If you look at the scheduled caste and scheduled tribe population, they are, if you look at globally, every one in the six person globally is from India, and within India, one in every six person is a former untouchable or a scheduled caste, and the atrocities on them, they have been, I'm not saying they have risen only now, they have been going on in spite of all kinds of enactments that have been made against the atrocities. But if you see the prosecution rate under the Atrocities Act, that's very small. And even in the state of Maharashtra, which is supposed to be very, very progressive, you'll be surprised that the prosecution rate under the Prevention of Atrocities Act is very, very small, one of the smallest in our country. That tells us that we have to do a lot more that we need to do. Harshadeep Ghuge has asked, how to prioritize ecological SDG with economic progress in our country? Again, a very, very good question. It is easier said than done, because whenever there is a question, there is a contrast, there is a choice, or there is a trade-off between ecological balance and economic growth, most people opt for economic growth. The best example is what happened to the Western Ghat. If you remember, there was a big report about the Western Ghat and the ecology of the Western Ghat was in trouble, and we wanted to, there was a very important report. Then there was a committee appointed by Planning Commission at that time to look into that. It became a very big political issue, and that is still not resolved. Madhav Gadigal came out with a big report. Then there was a committee which softened it. That committee was also opposed by politicians, so there was another committee. So that issue is still not resolved. But this is something that we have to take a view in future. Chetan Chavre says he is proud of you, sir. Thank you very much, Chetan. Rushikesh Deshmukh says, what do you think of economy of India in the next 5 years? Again, very good question. It's very brief answer would be that we are today, Indian economy is the fastest growing economy in the world. Earlier it was China which was number one, the fastest growing country in the world. Today it is India which is the fastest growing country in the world. But that does not mean all our problems are solved. We have many problems, many handicaps, many hindrances, and we have to get over that. And what I would imagine is that if we follow the right kind of economic policies, in the next 5 years, we should be able to cross the magical number of 10% double-digit growth. Reaching there is not very difficult. We have the potential, we have to have the right kind of economic policies to get there. But once we get there, the biggest challenge would be how do we sustain that kind of level? China achieved more than 10% growth rate for 30 years in a row. We are nowhere close to that. So first of all, we have to achieve that high growth, and after achieving, we have to sustain that. And for that, we need to make a large investment in two fields: education, skill development, and health sector. If we do not do that, we will not be able to use our demographic dividend, which has been fortuitously available, and that would be a big shame for which the future generations will never forgive us. Samadhan Dhepe is asking, what is your stand on Ambedkar Bhavan? Again, a very good question. Ambedkar Bhavan, first of all, let me say this. I'm not going to take any side, but I am saying this on behalf of all the Ambedkari Samaj, that breaking down of Buddha Bhushan printing press is a crime committed against Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar and his legacy. This should not have happened. Nobody was authorized to destroy a place which was for a very long time center of activity by Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar. He himself established that. And when we are buying small properties back when Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar had studied for some time, why are we destroying the basic nerve center of Dr. Ambedkar's political movement? This is unpardonable. I'm not taking the side of Ratnakar Gaikwad, nor I'm taking side of Prakash Ambedkar. But I feel very deeply hurt that nerve center of, once upon a time, a place which was nerve center of Babasaheb Ambedkar's movement has been demolished mindlessly by people for their selfish gains, for which I think it is an unpardonable offense. There's a question. Praveen Nikam is saying, hello sir, I'm Praveen Nikam, National Youth Awards, blah, blah, blah. Prashant Bhate is saying, sir, is GST any effect in Maharashtra? Of course, it will affect every stage. Let me tell you that there is a suspicion or a fear that a state like Maharashtra temporarily may lose some amount of revenue. But there is a provision in GST that for those states like Maharashtra, where there would be temporary losses, there is a provision that the losses would be compensated by the central government. So there is absolutely nothing to fear. There is only something more to gain. But for that, we should show that political maturity, which unfortunately is missing right now. Suraj Pagare is saying, sir, why don't you join the Babasaheb Ambedkar's Republican Party of India? Today, we all require a strong leader who will show the correct path. Who will show the correct path? I understand and appreciate your suggestion, Suraji, but I'm not going to join any political party. I do not want to join any political movement. What I want to do in the rest of my professional life is to go beyond party politics and focus on social issues and economic issues. You know, if everybody does politics, what is the point? Somebody has to go beyond the party politics, you know, beyond the party politics, and then at the national level, you have to address the social and economic issues. That is exactly what I hope to do in the parliament now that I have that opportunity. The question by Swapnil Ingle, is Brexit cause negative impact on Indian economy? No, there would be. See, the international economic environment is extremely fragile and unfavorable. Brexit adds to that uncertainty. So it can be bad for us to some extent, but we have been able to hold out ourselves very long. Brexit, on the other hand, can also be seen. It depends on the kind of policies that we follow. It can be seen as an actually seen as an opportunity as well. But things are, it's too early to comment on that. Mihir Asha Kisan Bhoir is saying, sir, how will you describe the path of your struggle to reach here? My path, the way I will describe my struggle is this, that it is entirely because of Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar's vision. I am what I am because of Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar. Babasaheb Ambedkar made a very large strata of society ask a very simple question, which was not asked for 3,000 years. The question was, it may be in the interest of others to be your masters. It may be in the interest of others to be your masters. Why should it be in your interest to be their slaves? This was the question which was not asked for thousands of years. Babasaheb Ambedkar made all very large society ask this question. And when they asked this question, they found their own, you know, they had lost their own dignity as a human being. They realized that they have as equal right like others to live the life of dignity, and that had changed everything. I am only a symbol of one person. You know, my father was a foot soldier in Ambedkari movement. That message of educate, organize and agitate came to me through my father. You know, it was Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar's vision, but that came to me through my father. And then it is the hard work and everything that happened is a big struggle, and that struggle has shown the results. But I maintain that this is only one of a very large number of people who are, you know, the kind of silent revolution that is taking place in our country across various income groups, even among Dalits. And that's a very positive sign. And that was because of Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar. I'm no exception. I'm just one of so many who have come up and are coming up. Ashutosh Pawar has asked, don't you think it is high time that the RBI implement stringent rules to bring NPAs of PSU banks under control and improve the asset quality of banks? Yes, indeed. But first thing that they have to do is to recognize that there are problems. You know, until now, it was not recognized that there was a big problem. But public sector bank NPAs have gone up and they are right now at a dangerous level. So a lot needs to be done. A very large amount of capitalization of public sector banks is required, and putting stringent system rules to bring the NPA, the PSU under control would have to be done. And I believe that is being done. Paresh Sawad has said, politics in India is in very bad taste today. What are your views? How could young individuals bring the change? Politics in India is very bad taste today. I agree. Everybody says that. But that doesn't mean you should stay away from that. If it is not good, then what is the point in staying out of it and complaining that it is not good? Who has given you right to just complain and stay within yourself? Many of these people who complain that, they don't even go for voting, exercising their voting rights. So if you are not satisfied with the quality of politics, get into that. That is my message to the younger generation. Get into that and change it. Remember what Mahatma Gandhi had said, you be the change that you desire. So if you think that politics is not good, it has to be improved, be in politics and change that. Sudarshan Pawar is saying, should we expect you in a bigger role in the near future? I do not know what do you mean by bigger role. I'm quite happy with the role that I'm playing and the opportunity which I have got now. But if I do get a bigger role, I'm always ready to take on the bigger roles and bigger responsibilities. Mihir Asha Kisan Bhoir has again asked, sir, we will really have a negative effect post the exit of Rajan? Absolutely not. Absolutely not. This is the kind of impression that has been created by media. I will assure you that the negative effect would be only temporary, and we are already over that. Remember, this happened at the time of Brexit, and the impact could have been terrible. But we have people, very competent people at the Reserve Bank of India. They anticipated everything, and the right measures were taken, and therefore the impact was not felt. So we have the wherewithal and ability to contain, to mitigate the damage, And we will be able to do that. And very soon, I think new governor will also be appointed. So do not be overly concerned by exit of one person. That cannot have a big damage permanently. And we are capable of handling that. Aniket Patil has asked, in 2020, where our rupee would stand in the world? India, Mahasatta Hoilka. Yes, in 2020, where will rupee stand? Nobody can tell you. If me or anybody can tell you where rupee or any exchange rate would stand, you can make incredible amount of money by just predicting that correctly. Nobody can do that. Whether India will be a Mahasatta, whether India will be a superpower, Rishikesh Deshmukh is asking. I believe that if we follow the right kind of economic policies, we have all the potential to become an economic superpower in the near future. We're talking about 5 to 10 years framework. The main reason is that we have something called demographic dividend. If you see, the average age of India today is only 24. And by the year 2020 that you are asking, our average age would be about 29. When our average age would be 29, the average age of China would be 38, America would be 38, China would be 38, and Western Europe would be 42, 43, and Japan would be 48, 49, which means that India has a tremendous advantage of having large and growing young population, and that can be a force that can lead India to become an economic superpower in none too distant future, provided that, you know, this demographic dividend is like a blank check. The check has a meaning only when it is encashed. Otherwise, it's only a piece of paper. So this potential that we have in terms of demographic dividend needs to be harnessed. And to harness that, we have to make investment in education, in skill development, and in the health sector. This was the main point that I made in my maiden speech, the first speech that I made in Rajya Sabha. Do take a look at that speech, 15-minute speech that I made. India can become a superpower, provided that we have the right kind of economic policies and we harness the demographic dividend. If we do not harness our demographic dividend, if we squander it, we can have a demographic disaster, because we will have only mouths to, we will have large mouths to feed, but no hands that can work. That would be a demographic disaster. So we are at a stage where human resource development management has become far more important than any other sector of our economy. Swapni Lingle is asking, what is your opinion on the controversy of the Tamil book, the name has been given, can judiciary stop asking literature to justify his aesthetic politics before bar? No, I'm afraid I do not know all the details about that, so I'm not in a position to answer that. Nilesh Bandekar has asked, how can we achieve a world where people will be valued based on their virtues rather than their status, color of the skin, caste, religion of which they follow? Now, this is the most important question, but most difficult to respond to. We have to move in the direction where, you know, we establish, you know, the founding fathers of our country. I would suggest that you please read the debates in the Constituent Assembly. There are 7 volumes, big volumes of Constituent Assembly debates, where 295 people, the best minds in our country, talked about India and the future of India. And they were the ones who discussed and debated every provision of the Constitution of India. And they talked about the vision of Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar and the vision of Indian Constitution was to establish a casteless society, you know, which is a secular one, casteless society, classless society, secular in nature, and that is why everything that we have done in the Constitution is aimed at that. So one way of doing it is to implement our Constitution most faithfully in letter and spirit to achieve the intended results that you desire. Vinay Kale is saying, what are your success habits and how you solve problems of your stressful problems? That is a very, very good question. I have spoken on this subject many times. I would suggest that please read a book called Le Savi, Laguttam Sadharan Vibhajak, Le Savi Majha Samagra Abhivyaktisa. In that book, there are 60 articles and speeches. One of the speech is Yashachi Nau Sutre. So there is a 7-point formula that I have developed, and with the anecdotes, etc., I have explained. Please take a look at that and you will get the answer. How do you solve your stressful problems? The only way to solve the stressful problems is to face them, not to get away or not to move away from that. Vinay Kate has asked that question. Vinay Kate has asked that question. Then there is a question about Omkar Sanjay Halaskar has said, Sir, Indu Mill should be the world's biggest library in the world, I think. What is the thought at this point? Will you raise the point in Rajya Sabha, because this is a proper tribute to Dr. Ambedkar? Of course, there are many issues that can be raised. As you are talking about the biggest library, we have to make sure that we read a lot. For that, there are enough libraries available. Now, for example, I have written 20 books on Dr. Ambedkar in Marathi, 8 in Marathi, 8 in English, and 4 in Hindi. How many people have read all of them? Please do that. The intellectual biography of Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar that I wrote, is, I think, very, very important. These are all very, very big books. The Le Savi, the book Le Savi that I was talking about, I will show you. This is that book, Le Savi. But on Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar, I have written extensively. Please read those thoughts. My complaint and my problem is this, that those 22 volumes which have been produced by the government of Maharashtra, it's a great thing that they have done, but they have not been organized properly. Lot of people I know, they have bought all those volumes and they have kept it in a sacred place in the house. Some of them even worship them, but very few of them try to read it. I think it is important not to have big library per se. By itself, it is necessary, but that's not sufficient. What is important is to read what is available. Not many people are doing that, especially in the younger generation. And that's my complaint, that's my problem, and that's a cause for concern for me. Then there is a question. I think we have spoken a lot. Let's leave some questions for future. Time is really up. I must say that I have been enjoying talking to all of you. It has been a wonderful experience. And we must have these sessions, more sessions like this. More questions, more sessions. What I would suggest is that please leave your comments below. Let's think about how can we make this more effective. So please leave your comments on how to make these kind of sessions more effective. And friends, remember to follow me on Twitter. And if you are not on Twitter, go and get registered on Twitter. Thank you. Thank you very much.